We're about now 3 minutes out of Christchurch Airport, and on our starboard side we can see two very bright lights, one much brighter than the other. It is like a very, very bright star, and just below it is another light, not quite so bright.
Just before midnight, Fogarty goes airborne with New Zealand cargo pilot Bill Startup. The beginning of the flight is uneventful. Then at 12.05 a.m., Fogarty and the crew see strange lights and objects coming toward them from the right side of the plane. Fogarty turns on his camera and begins filming.
Those two lights appear to be traveling with us. They're still off the starboard wing. The brighter light is still above the other, and it's moved a little further ahead of the other. It's extremely bright, much brighter than any of the other stars in the sky.
Ground radar observes these objects, and the control tower confirms the sighting and records the conversation. What follows is the actual audio of this unusually well-documented event.
The storm target showing at 11 o'clock at 3 miles. Just left at 9 o'clock at 8 miles.
Captain Startup recounts that the object, or target, is initially ahead of him, then travels at an unbelievable speed past his left side. He quickly banks the plane left in an attempt to make visual contact. On the ground, Wellington Air Traffic Control radios a chilling message to the captain. They've picked up yet another target on his left side, and this one is closing in on the plane.
Looking over towards the right of the aircraft, and we have an object confirmed by Wellington radar. It's been following us for quite a while. It's about 4 miles away, and it looks like a very faint star, but then emits a very bright white green light.
Captain Startup is able to get close enough to determine that the object is an array of bright blue lights pulsing at a rapid rate. To his shock, the object has gotten bigger.
There was an interesting radar event where the object got so close to the aircraft it looked to Wellington radar as if the aircraft radar target image had doubled in size.
Strong target, right in formation with you now, your target has doubled in size.
The double-sized target continues to appear on radar screens for 36 seconds, then returns back to normal size.
Yeah, blue light's right there. This is the object which was apparently traveling along with the aircraft. It was picked up on aircraft radar.
Dr. Bruce Maccabee received a 16-millimeter copy of the Argosy UFO film directly from the Australian TV network in 1979.
Roll 4, take 10.
This complete and unedited film has never been made available before. Experts believe that these images are the most comprehensive and frightening UFO evidence ever captured on film.
This is the famous New Zealand film obtained the night of December 31st, 1978. The cameraman is sitting in the seat between the pilot and the co-pilot. The image is dancing around because he was carrying it on his shoulder. They saw this light to their right. And this light, as time goes on, will fade in and out, takes on various shapes. This is the flashing light that you have to slow down and look at frame by frame to see what happens. When it goes from very bright white down to dim orange, you can see the image went over to the side, then he turned the camera a little bit in order to pull it back into the center.
That other target that has been following us has now been joined by two others, so we now, at this stage, have three unidentified flying objects just off our right wing, and they've been following us, or one of them has been following us now for probably about 10 minutes.
And that's the way it is. Or is it? Monday, January 1st, 1979. This is Walter Cronkite, CBS News. Good night.
Coming up, while the Apollo 11 astronauts were the first men to set foot on the moon, they were not the first to make reports of sightings of the unknown in outer space. Pilot sightings of UFOs are not exclusive to Earth's atmosphere. In the early 1960s, as America and the Soviet Union escalate the space race, astronauts and cosmonauts begin to witness strange and unexplained objects and events in outer space.
You know, 1958, when NASA formed, they literally expected to make contact with extraterrestrial life.
December 4th, 1965. 4 hours and 24 minutes into the historic 14-day mission, the astronauts of Gemini 7, Frank Borman and James Lovell, both military test pilots, are performing routine tasks. Then suddenly, at 22:34 Universal Time, as the capsule is high above Hawaii, both men see a bright object, or bogey, flying above their capsule. Borman radios mission control in Houston. What follows are the actual radio transmissions. The recording suddenly ends. NASA insists the sighting is Gemini's Titan booster rocket. Lovell replies that he can see the booster as well as, quote, several actual sightings.
I remember hearing this on my car radio, talked to NASA, and they confirmed that that was the phrase used, we have a bogey in sight.
In NASA's official Gemini 7 mission report, published in January 1966, no mention is ever made of the infamous bogey recording. Neither Lovell nor Borman have ever commented publicly on this message.
But as far as the American public is concerned, NASA denies the very existence of UFOs they've been covering up since the dawn of spaceflight.
From the early years of the space program, NASA was beset with sighting reports from astronauts. September 13, 1966. Gemini 11 astronauts Richard Gordon and Charles Pete Conrad see something strange on their 16th revolution of Earth, 27 hours and 47 minutes after takeoff. Conrad radios ground control. He reports he has just seen an unidentified object about 50 miles downrange. It is metallic and revolving at more than one revolution per second. He then pulls out a camera and snaps three photographs. It drops down in front of them before quickly disappearing. Seen here are the actual photographs taken by Conrad aboard Gemini 11.
And NORAD said that the only thing that they could imagine it was a booster from a Russian satellite. The NASA people threw out the NORAD explanation almost immediately. The Gemini 11 case is the only one that NASA considers to be unidentified.
Gemini 11, however, was not the last NASA mission to have alleged encounters with UFOs. In fact, more and more UFO sightings were reported as Gemini opened the door to the Apollo program.
The Apollo astronauts in particular were trailed by UFOs.
It is alleged that Neil Armstrong, you know, saw UFOs. Many of the astronauts did, but they won't talk about it publicly yet, but they might.
Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
The famous Apollo 11 mission reportedly experienced objects tracking the capsule, as well as objects that were photographed by the astronauts on the lunar surface. 4 months later, on November 14, 1969, Apollo 12 commander Pete Conrad reports back to NASA that he sees an unidentified object out his window.
An object which is in the same place all the time but appears to be tumbling. Well, we've had it ever since yesterday. It just seems to be tagging along with us.
While the object is widely considered to be debris falling from the booster, many researchers remain skeptical. They suggest such an object would be incapable of tracking a fast-moving space capsule for an extended period of time. As the Apollo missions open the door to the space shuttle program, experts are convinced the door was also open to an increased level of UFO activity in outer space. In 1981, NASA initiates the space shuttle program, and with it, an unprecedented wave of UFO sightings, including astounding audio and video evidence. One highly controversial recording emerges from STS-29, a space shuttle discovery flight on March 13, 1989. astronaut John Blaha reports the sighting of something unusual.
One of the NASA transmissions that wasn't successfully sanitized, back in 1989, one of the astronauts on a space shuttle said, "We're still looking at the aliens." It was as plain as day.
The following recording was reportedly intercepted by a ham radio operator in Maryland. To this day, NASA has neither confirmed nor denied the validity of this transmission.
The space shuttle has two radio channels. One is a public channel that we all hear when NASA is broadcasting. We can hear what the astronauts are saying. The other channel is a Department of Defense encrypted channel. And that's where I believe the real conversations are going on.
The new millennium ushered in more UFO sightings by NASA shuttle crews. One extraordinary recording occurred aboard Space Shuttle Flight STS-73. Mission specialist Catherine Coleman sees something curious on day three of the routine 15-day mission.
This is October 21st, 1995.
We have an unidentified flying object.
And nothing after. I mean, there she is. Catherine's just floating around in there. And that's where I believe they went on to the Department of Defense encrypted channel on the space shuttle, and they continued the conversation.
Researcher David Cereda has been studying unusual phenomena in outer space for over a decade. It is his theory that NASA continued recording, but on a secret frequency, leaving us with more questions than answers.
We have an unidentified flying object.
Even recent shuttle missions have had eerie reports and sightings of strange objects. According to Cereda, some of the most shocking evidence of UFOs in outer space comes as recently as August 6, 2005, from Space Shuttle Flight STS-114.
Well, the space shuttle is doing 18,000 miles an hour around the Earth. So the object is traveling obviously much faster than 18,000 miles an hour to catch up to the shuttle, to fly in tandem speed with it, and then it takes off and goes back out the other way. This is real footage from the space shuttle. Even considering that it may be just a few miles away from the space shuttle, it's obviously a very large UFO.
The object enters quickly, dramatically changes speed and direction, then flies back out of frame. The trajectory and speed of the object defy all laws of physics, leaving researchers like Cereda to draw their own conclusions.
When you zoom in on video frames or any digital media, you get pixelation. So some of the rectangular shapes you see are pixels, but notice also you can see the round aura of light around it. So you can still differentiate shapes within the pixels. There's no way that's dust and debris. There's no way it's another satellite. When you go through process of elimination, you know that what we're seeing in STS-114 is truly a UFO. There's really nothing else out there like that.
Since NASA does not comment on the topic of UFOs, the authenticity of space recordings and sightings cannot be officially confirmed, which leaves many questions unanswered.
UFOs constantly trailed our spaceships around planet Earth, the space shuttle, but more importantly, all the Apollo, the Project Apollo spacecraft on the way to the moon.
I think a lot of astronauts are going to start coming forward and testifying to what they have seen.
My impression is that the guys who go running around saying the NASA stuff proves something are hyping it.
As Earth's airspace grows more and more crowded each day and more people than ever take to the skies, is it possible that reports like the ones you've just seen will continue?
There are reams and reams of official reports by commercial aircraft, by private aircraft, and military aircraft about pilot encounters. Even if, while we're sitting right here in California, a UFO turned up over Santa Monica Bay, you'd probably hear a great explanation of how it was a reflection of the sun behind the cloud.
So many reports from so many experienced pilots of strange phenomena and frightening encounters with UFOs since the beginning of manned flight. As our pilots fly through Earth's atmosphere and further into space, many continue to wonder, do the skies truly belong to us or to them?
3179, we got a passenger taking a picture of it right now.
Right. Looks like a UFO. half a million acres of land, thousands of workers, billions of dollars in development, schools, stores, movie theaters, and still, no one knew it existed. The biggest American secret of all time is now uncovered. Hidden cities dedicated to the race for the first atomic bomb. The Lost Worlds, next on the History Channel.